got our championship match coming up for the IBF Cruiserweight title. Christoph Larchek and Steve Cunningham up next.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome, he is making his way into the ring from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, in the United States of America, here is Steve USS Cunningham.
And you get a look at the challenger making his entrance into the ring for this IBF Cruiserweight Championship fight. This rematch. Guys engaged in both their previous efforts. A mandated rematch under odd circumstances. This is Steve USS Cunningham. Lost a disputable and controversial close decision. A split decision to Larchek last time out. Both guys waited around, Cunningham especially so, and nobody administered a urine test. And so the IBF mandated this rematch. Immediate rematch of the two fighters. I think Cunningham was deserving because I thought it was very questionable given that victory to Larchek, even though he was fighting in front of his home fans at home.
Yeah, you know, I saw that fight, and we did that fight. And it's a questionable decision, and, you know, I would like to see Cunningham come out here tonight and establish himself a little bit more than he did that night and pick up a win here, because I believe he was deserving of the win last night.
Classic boxer, Steve USS Cunningham, has very adept footwork, good hand speed, and have a huge advantage in terms of reach over Larchek. He's a much more compact fighter. Larchek, if he did win that fight, impressed the judges with late round one-punch power punches. But I thought Steve Cunningham deserved a better fate than that. Climbs into the ring tonight. He has to be confident. I'm sure that's a springboard. You've been in these situations where you fight a rematch. The normal adage in boxing, Glenn, is that whoever won the first fight wins the second one more convincingly. That's not always the case, as was evidenced by your two matchups with Antonio Tarver, both very close fights. And you did win the first one. They took the second one perhaps from you. But Cunningham has to feel pretty good about himself in this matchup tonight, thinking that he did win the fight and he's got an immediate reprieve with a chance to redeem himself.
Well, a lot of times the decision play a part in your head, what the judges say, but you know in your heart, and the people watch the fight know who won the fight. And sometimes that's all you have to hang your hat on. And that's where you should get your biggest motivation to come out here and say, I proved to myself and the audience last time, but now I got to come out and convince the judges of what's happening in the ring.
The man's very quiet during the arrival in the ring of Steve Cunningham. That should change right here as the hometown favorite, Christoph Larchek, IBF Cruiserweight champion, is set to make his entrance into the ring. Intro in Polish. Well, Steve Corbo is going to be able to duplicate that.
Making his way into the ring, the champion, Krzysztof Diablo, 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 Bogdanczyk.
Well, he set that one up in grand style. Obviously a little bit of the devil in Larchek. His nickname Diablo. They emphasized that three times in two different languages for a total of six. And here he is. We'll see if he can be as menacing as his introduction was. He steps in there against Steve USS Cunningham in this much anticipated rematch.
Well, let's see if we can get this fight a little more exciting than the last one. The last one was a good fight, but it wasn't enough for us to jump out of our seat. And hopefully we have a bigger and more exciting fight tonight. The introduction was certainly exciting.
There's Christoph Larchek, the IBF Cruiserweight Champion. I thought, even if this was not mandated, that the way the fight was contested, it was deserving of a rematch. If you are Larchek, you'd like to see a champion that'll give a guy who lost a tough decision or close disputed decision another shot before you move on and start taking on other opponents. cruiserweight, kind of the redheaded stepchild of the boxing world. Not a lot of distinguished champions. We've had a few guys that have gone on to the heavyweight title out of the cruiserweight division, most notably Evander Holyfield, who started out as a cruiserweight and stepped up to the big money in the heavyweight division. But for some reason, now a 200-pound weight limit, originally 190, this division has been largely ignored.
Well, and it ignored for the same reason you just said. As soon as these guys establish themselves and become a star, they move up in the heavyweight division to try to make the bigger money. And that's one of the reasons why this weight class, they're big enough to fight heavyweight, but they don't hang around this weight division because it's not enough money.
For Steve Corbo.
Of the United States of America.
We've got a couple of national anthems. We'll get Glenn refocused on the belt and not who's holding.
Well, when you have the opportunity, you can look at all pretty things.
Be careful.
The belt is definitely the thing that I'm looking at the most.
Light applause for the American anthem and Steve USS Cunningham. And now the Polish national anthem.
Ladies and gentlemen, the judges assigned to work this bout are at ringside from Mexico, Alejandro
Look at Steve Cunningham, 19-1. Marchek coming in at 37-1. The younger of the two fighters. Cunningham's been around a lot. He's had 24 fights.
Yeah, both of these guys are they fight for the championship for the second time.
A good look, the menacing presence. Krzysztof Walarczyk. Narrow decision victory, a split decision over Cunningham last time.
First boxing at blue corner, he is dressed in the blue trunks with the white trim. He weighed in at even 192 pounds and brings into the ring a professional record of 19 wins against only one loss, with 10 of those wins coming by way of knockout. From Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, in the United States of America, introducing the challenger, Steve U.S.S. Cunningham! And ladies and gentlemen, his opponent boxing out of the red corner. He is dressed in the white trunks with the blue trim. He weighed in at 196 pounds and comes to us this evening with an outstanding professional record of 37 wins with only one loss and 27 of those big wins coming by way of knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, is the current reigning and defending IBF Cruiserweight Champion of the World from Poland. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Krzysztof Diablo!
Set to go here for round number one, the IBF Cruiserweight Championship on the line here. There's the defending champion, Krzysztof Walarczyk, 37-1, fighting in his homeland once again. A menacing presence, certainly has a game face on Glenn Johnson. This time out against Steve USS Cunningham. Really threw a scant number of punches, but was able to eke out a narrow, and as we've said, a very disputable decision. Here we go, Cunningham is the taller of the two fighters and immediately begins on the ropes, trying to establish that jab. Now back out in the center of the ring. A couple of range finders by Steve Cunningham. Thought he really dictated the pace in the early stages of their first fight. Walarczyk won whatever number of rounds he achieved on the scorecards, mostly by late round, final 30-second one punch, power punch, landing against Cunningham. And that's what made it disputable for me. I kind of favor the busier fighter on the scorecards.
Well, you see Cunningham is using his jab nicely, trying to hold on here to get himself out of trouble. But it come back and start establishing the jab earlier on in the round. And I like to see that. I like to see when a guy uses a jab.
Is there a different psyche for a fighter going into a rematch? These two guys, you say familiarity breeds contempt. They both seem to be great sportsmen. There's no particular tension between the two, either before their last fight, during their last fight, obviously competitive, but both seem to be gentlemen, and I think certainly on Cunningham's part, very happy to be back in there. I don't know if Walarczyk is as happy to see Cunningham as is the reverse.
Well, Cunningham, he's on the losing side of it, so he certainly is happy to get the rematch and an opportunity to redeem himself. And he's doing a good job so far. He's the busier guy. He's using the jab. He's throwing the long right hand into the body. And he's tying up when he feel uncomfortable. He just tie up and get the distance again.
See the hand speed of Steve USS Cunningham as he tries to get off the mark quickly here. After tasting defeat at the hands of the judges last time around. Inside of 1 minute to go in round number one. Walarczyk a little bit more active. than he was in the early stages of their first meeting.
Well, you know, he's trying to show that he really won the first fight. And he's trying to establish himself right away.
He really laid back, especially in the first six rounds of their first go-round. His good power, 27 knockouts from 37 wins, only one defeat for Vlahovic. Fighting primarily in Europe against a smattering of opponents that probably need to buy a foul for us to get into. 10 seconds to go, inside 10 seconds. Round number one, it's been a good fast pace here. Nice opening stanza.
Good starting, both of these guys starting very nicely.
Not an easy round to score. Ready to go to the pencil here, Glenn. I don't know how you saw that first round. Cunningham was active. I don't know that he landed so many fingers.
By moving his hands, yeah. The other guy just staying safe by covering up. Here you see him coming, trying to do some damage, missing everything. And soon as Cunningham gets uncomfortable, they Cunningham throwing some shots. Nothing serious, but they landed. That's the difference in the fight so far.
Long, lanky fighter is Steve Cunningham. Not a big power puncher with 10 knockouts from his 19 victories. Very skilled and very adept. He can look awkward at times, but yet he seems to be on balance. Good footwork, and obviously he's masterful at working a jab and keeping his opponents at bay.
Now you see Cunningham come out here. He's dropping the left hand. He's still using the jab, but he's having it hanging by his waist here. So anytime you throw a straight right hand.
Picking up his intensity here in his second round of this fight. Starts to apply more pressure to Vlahovic than he did in round number one. Bit of a range finder type round for Cunningham in round one. He has to be more intense on finding the target in the second round.
Well, this is a fast pace fight. You know, these guys are not exactly standing around.
There was a startling similarity, your two fights with Antonio Tarver. They went down in very much the same fashion. Is there a tendency to want to change things up, even though you competed in a close fight, change your strategy a little bit, or is that even necessary when you get into a rematch?
Well, the person that lost the fight is the one that want to make the most changes, because whatever you did in the first fight didn't convince the judges, so you want to come out and do something a little bit different. The guy who won the fight feel like, well, I won it, so it's not much I need to change. I just need to probably do what I did and make few adjustments to change minds of people who might think that I didn't win the fight. So I'm just gonna turn it up a notch and convince those people and convince my opponent that I beat you last night.
Good round so far, first couple of minutes for Steve Cunningham. Vlahovic showing just a very tepid pawing jab, not much of a jabber, is Christoph Vlahovic. He seems content to try and land one of those roundhouse rights. Dave Parris is the third man in the ring in this one. Good doubling up of the jab, though, by Steve Cunningham. That could be impressive. He's got a jab and left hook a couple of times, too, so he's really showing some piston-like activity.
Cunningham is using his jab. He's truly trying to establish himself. He's really trying to win this fight. And he's taking the bigger risk, more chances. And when he gets uncomfortable, he ties up.
And the challenge for Vlahovic, as it was in the first fight, is cutting the distance. It's a guy with this type of range. Cunningham with a big reach advantage. Vlahovic wanting to get inside to do his damage. Hasn't been able to do so. An excellent second round here for Steve Cunningham from a tactical standpoint.
I think Cunningham is winning this round, even though convincingly that he did the first round.
I would agree. We're unanimous on that. End of round number two, scheduled for 12. feeling out process going on here with Steve Cunningham. Definitely applying much more pressure in the second round and seemingly finding an effective home for those left hands that he was tossing out there. Marchek a little bit puzzled in the second round of this fight, as he was here in the stadium with our first game.
Well, Cunningham is using his jab, he's finding a range. In the first fight, he was trying to throw some wide right hands, and he's not doing that so much in this fight. He's using his jab, and he's landing most of them. He's doing some left hooks in there, and, you know, they're very effective. And he's dropping the right hand when you get opportunity, and he ties up as soon as he get uncomfortable, as soon as the guy gets a little bit too close, he just time up and start over. The referee come in, break it up. Here you can see him using that jab. Where go the body shots with the right hand. And he come back with the body shot with the left hand.
And a doubling and tripling of the left hand, posing a problem now for Vlarchik as he tries to cut the distance on Steve Cunningham. Hasn't been able to cut off the ring. Cunningham is going to be an elusive target no matter who he's up against. Here's round three, scheduled 12th rounder. IBF Cruiserweight Championship at stake. Jeff DeForest and the Road Warrior, Glenn Johnson. Certainly familiar with this type of championship tilt. Steve Cunningham and Vlarchik in a rematch. And right now they're in the center of the ring trying to establish each other as being the superior guy in round number three. In the first fight between these two, most of the rounds were mirror images of the previous ones. You saw round one, you probably could have envisioned round number 12. And it's been somewhat the case here, although, as you said, Glenn, Cunningham much more effective in the second round with the same tactics he used in round number one. I have a win in the first two rounds of this fight.
Yeah, well, you know, these guys, they're familiar with each other, so it's not so much of a feeling out process like you did in the first fight. You know, they know. They have some idea about each other, what they're going to do. So they come out here and just picked up right where they left off. And Cunningham so far doing a better job.
Looked like he was trying to score a takedown there. Looked like a college wrestling match there for a second as he was spinning out while he had Vlarchik in a headlock. But maybe a wise tactic by Cunningham. If Vlarchik gets inside, we know he's dangerous. And as long as the referee will allow it to go on, I don't know that there's any problem with Cunningham trying to tie him up.
Well, when you get on the inside, if it's not your game, you want to time up. I mean, that's not where you want to be. You're uncomfortable there. You time up, get your distance again, and start over.
And there's a trend now in boxing, at least a movement of foot. I don't know how effective it will be, to try and put some emphasis on the guy who is the busier fighter, the guy who's making the fight, getting the edge, however slight it is, on his scorecards. And you're trying to decipher and determine who won a close round. And I kind of like that. Philosophically, I agree with that. Cunningham's been the busier guy. The crowd leaped to its feet earlier in this round. And I don't know that Vlarchik really landed anything at that stage. They're just looking for something to cheer about for the hometown guy. But look at the activity of Steve Cunningham here. You have to be impressed by it.
Well, you know, me being a boxer myself, I know that when you're in the ring and you're moving your hands, you open yourself up for opportunity for the other guy to throw punches. So you have to respect the guy that's moving his hands. He's taking the chances, he's taking the risk, and he's opening himself up for counter punches and for bigger shots. So me as a fighter, I have to, when I see a guy in the ring taking those kind of chances, I give him the ultimate respect than the other guy that's trying to be careful. And not taking those kind of risks, those kind of chances.
See, in round number three, another good one. In our estimation, for Steve USS Cunningham, he built a large advantage on our scorecards in the first fight. However, we were rebuffed by the judges. One guy had Vlarchik in that fight, 119-109. He gave one round to Steve Cunningham. And that was kind of a shocker, a bit of a travesty. And even the crowd, who was obviously in favor of the hometown guy, Vlarchik, was somewhat disappointed in the way that fight was scored, even though they were happy to get the win. Here's action for round number three. And you see that Vlarchik with that right hand, for the most part, he connected there, but for the most part, it's been like bobbing for apples. He's been having a tough time finding Steve Cunningham in range for an effective punch.
Yeah, he's missing most of his punches. Cunningham doing some good work right here. You see him on
the inside. Boy, that's his game, huh?
Throwing those body shots. And he's landing.
Here's round four, a trend already established in this fight. The hand speed, the good left hand of Steve Cunningham. And the right hand, the bomb, that's waiting to explode from Christoph Walarczyk. So far, advantage Cunningham. I have him up 3-0 in this one. I don't know that the judges will see it the same way. They seldom do, but Cunningham doing what he has to do, Glenn, if he's going to come away with the IBF Cruiserweight Championship, something he's waited a long, long time for.
Well, he's doing the right thing. You know, he's fighting a smart fight here, and he's keeping the crowd out of it. Every time the crowd try to pump up Diablo and they cheer that sound, they echo that Diablo, Diablo, you know, they stop. And the reason why Cunningham is doing such a good job, here they go again, saying Diablo, and we see how long it lasts this time.
They're blowing Diablo. That would be Christoph Walarczyk. He'd be a little bit busier fighter. I don't know if that's in his nature. Having seen him a couple of times, and we saw the last 12-rounder against Cunningham, he's been a little bit more active in the early portion of this fight than he was in that one. But still, if you're using punch stat or counting up the power punches that landed, I think you'd be in single digits in every round so far for Walarczyk.
Cunningham doing a wonderful job. And Diablo now punching him behind the head. He's not doing anything to win this fight. And he's keeping the crowd trying to get him pumped up, but he's not pumped up.
Cunningham has his task. It's a simple one. Keep Walarczyk off of him. Keep him at a distance. Keep him on the end of that left hand. Keep bouncing around in the center of the ring, and then get busy.
And when he get on the inside, time up. Throw a couple of quick body shots in there and time up as soon as you finish punching.
Can't let this kid do any damage. Walarczyk is a dangerous puncher, as we know. Cunningham seems to have a pretty solid chin. Good set of whiskers on this kid for a guy that not necessarily built as the prototypical cruiserweight. Very tall for a guy in this division. And a sensational reach advantage over most guys that he faces. Inside the final minute of round number 4. Again, good inside work by Steve Cunningham.
Time up right after your finish.
Shot after the break by Walarczyk, and I think Dave Parris is going to admonish him for that. He's talking to both guys. But we clearly saw Walarczyk throw a left hook after the ref tried to separate. Cunningham answers back. Looks like he's gaining confidence as the fight goes on.
Oh, what happened?
And Walarczyk is on the canvas.
Steve, Bonnie! Steve, Bonnie!
Calling this a knockdown. Seems to be having some difficulty. I didn't see where there was a dynamic enough punch to knock Walarczyk to the canvas. Here comes Cunningham. Maybe trying to close the show, and here's the bell to save it. It's an odd knockdown if I ever witnessed.
Yes.
Walarczyk just appeared to be having some kind of trouble
there. I don't see what happened. I didn't miss me. I think maybe there's a head trap or something.
Almost like Lewis Dimension, where we're looking at a film of Ali and Liston as if it was the Intruder film. I find a punch here. Many times as I've seen it, I'm still having difficulty seeing where Liston went down. But Walarczyk in the corner saying, oh, yeah, there it is. That's a shot. This is later action in the round. That was a short left hand. He caught him, and Walarczyk was definitely a shot like that result in a knockdown.
I don't know what happened there.
Kind of a delayed reaction there. It was kind of interesting. Here's round number 5, scheduled for 12. Steve Cunningham, nonetheless, coming up with a 10-8 round. Glenn Johnson and I have him winning every round of the fight, and now well ahead on the scorecard. So perhaps a good omen for him making amends for what some people thought was a travesty the first time around.
Well, he's on his way. He's on his way. You know, he's doing the right thing. He's working well from the outside, and he's tying up when the guy gets on the inside, like he's showing right here. He's trapped in the corner, and he's not giving him any room to do any damage. And the referee come break him up. As soon as he do that, he starts right over, throwing punches, using the jab. And he's smuggling the punches right here. He's leaning in, kind of smuggling.
It's up to Walarczyk, too, to create punching at this point, isn't it? If Cunningham's going to hang on, he knows this is going to be his tactic. Doesn't he need to do something tactically to try and find some punching room instead of just conceding the clinch to Steve Cunningham?
Well,
here we go again. He's not really active inside those clinches where maybe he could free himself up and land one of those big devastating shots.
Well, he's the guy that needs to work more so on the inside than Cunningham. But Cunningham is beating him to the punches even on the inside before Cunningham time up. So right here, that's pretty good work right there. But then Cunningham had him on the retreat.
Cunningham's right left, writing the story so far in this fight. He hasn't thrown that many right hands, but he's been extremely strong with that left. He's been flashing it consistently since the opening bell. And right now, that is the dominating element of this fight. Midway through round number five of a scheduled 12 rounder.
He's using that jab. And he's using his left hand. He's using the jab to the body. He's using it as a hook. And, you know, he's doing very good work with the left hand. He haven't established any domination with the right hand yet.
Marchick trying to come on now. That's his most effective flurry of the fight, albeit two punches. And,
well,
seemed to me we had about a minute to go there in round number five, Glenn. And the bell rings. The referee is over talking, not even to the timekeeper. It looks like he's collecting scorecards or doing some other administrative duty. And it looked to me like that was a two-minute round.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I just heard you say halfway through the round.
I saw the clock. The timing device was up there, superimposed on the screen. We had about a minute and a half to go, and I thought Marchick was trying to collect himself, maybe still a little bit dazed and confused from that fourth-round knockdown that he suffered with a delayed reaction, which sometimes would mean that maybe he's not in full control of his faculties. Had to take a knee in the aftermath, about a second count after the punch landed. And it seemed like he was a little bit out of it there in the early stages of the round. It could be a telling factor in his fight, a two-minute round here in round number five of a championship fight, and nothing said about it. Dave Parris, looks as if nothing was unusual about that.
Yeah, that's going on as usual. You know, it's just like it was a full round. Nobody said anything and nothing done. And I guess maybe we wrong, but I don't think so. I think that was a two-minute round, but here we go nevertheless.
Well, until that last two-punch combination that Marchick tried, the fans in the stands looked like they were being lulled somewhat to sleep by his performance, and they might have thought it was 3 minutes, but we're almost sure that that was a two-minute round, an oddity occurring. What would boxing be without some controversy in an IBF Cruiserweight Championship fight? Nobody around the ring seemed to be upset about it. You didn't hear any protests from either corner. Dave Parris went on with his business as usual.
Well, I'm sure the fighters not going to have any protests about it. That's just less work for them to do. They got a minute extra, less than what they need to do. If that was me, unless I had the man hurt and I was at an advantage at the time when the bell rang. But
didn't seem like that was the case here, so perhaps it wouldn't be something that would be immersed in controversy, but it was an oddity nonetheless. Do you have a clock in your head as a fighter? Are you aware when you're fighting, especially in heated exchanges, that, hey, I got to last another minute or so? I would imagine you develop a certain sense of timing about the 3 minutes.
After a while, you have a sense of, you know, where you are. You don't have an exact timing down, but for the most part, you have a good idea what part of the round you're in and how long you have to go in the round.
I've seen that when you've been in the kitchen, Glenn. That three-minute egg you make is outstanding. Right on the money every time.
And I made a pretty good egg, I must say.
We're hoping something heats up here. Belarczyk, similar performance as the last time out. It's almost a carbon copy of their first fight.
And here we go with the rope with the apron again.
We saw that become a big problem in the 10th round of our previous bout, an outstanding matchup between Jonak and Shubhoff, and both guys were skating around, just sliding around like they were in the Olympic speed skating there in the last two rounds of the fight. We thought it might carry over to this one. Hasn't been too much of a problem, but Cunningham's starting to slip as he plants.
Well, you know, as the guys sweat and these things get wet and a little more slippery and slidey, you know, the guys start sliding around. So always in the later part of the fight, as the round go on, you're going to see you have more problems with your footing.
And you're wondering when Belarczyk is going to get the message that he probably needs to pick up the pace. He seems to stay still be bothered by what took place in the fourth round when he, in an odd fashion, went to the canvas, a delayed reaction to a short punch on the inside. Only knocked down the fight so far, and here's the end of round number six, so we're halfway through it, and we've established that these two guys are going to be facsimiles of what they were in their first meeting. For my money, nothing's changed, and even on the scorecards, I still have Cunningham well ahead. I've had trouble finding a round you can give to Blarchik.
Well, and that's sometimes is a disadvantage fighting at home because you're giving yourself the idea that the judge is going to give you the benefit of the doubt. And if you don't work as hard as you can, you should. I hope Diablo pick it up here and give us an exciting fight. Cunningham certainly did what he has to do to win on the road. He's tying up when he's at comfortable, he's using his jab, he's keeping distance. Even though the last round, they spent a great deal of it.
A little bit of a love fest for Sam Glenn Johnson, the road warrior. Last time out, scorecards read 116-112. I thought that was pretty much in line with the way the fight was. That one judge voting for Cunningham, the other two, and this was where it really got odd. At a 116, 115, 113 for Vilarchik. You could almost live with that 119, 109 Vilarchik. The deciding vote, giving Cunningham only one round. And as we've seen so far, if you watch the first six, it's pretty hard to find rounds that Vilarchik won cleanly in any of those first six frames. Here we go, round number seven, second half of the fight. See if the pace can escalate here. IBF Cruiserweight Championship on the line. Steve Cunningham out of Philadelphia, PA. And of course, that's a fabled fight town, with the Blue Horizon being one of the great boxing arenas and venues anywhere the world over, as Jimmy Lennon would say. A lot of great Philadelphia fighters, of course, the most famous probably being Smoking Joe Frazier. No physical similarity here, Cunningham and Joe Frazier. Matthew Saad Muhammad, formerly Matthew Franklin out of Philadelphia. And Wilbur Banaway, a cutie. Jeff Chandler, also from Philadelphia, PA, among many others.
What about the Hitman Hearn? Was he out of Philadelphia?
Detroit.
Front
gym. Maybe those yellow trunks. Manuel Stewart, Hitman Hearns. Still a big Detroit Piston fan. They're out of the playoffs, of course, but this was a guy that was always in attendance at the basketball games. And, what a warrior he was. That fight with Sugar Ray Leonard, the first one, just sensational stuff. We haven't seen that type of action yet in this one here. We're hoping it heats up to that point. Midway through round number seven, scheduled for 12. And the pace, if anything, is slowing down a little bit. Vilarchik trying to pick it up. And doing some good work for the first time in the inside. Steve Cunningham, the crowd is gone. Minute to go here, round number seven. We've got a knockdown, we've got a two-minute round, and we finally have Vilarchik showing signs of life, Glenn.
Well, you know, that's one of the things. When you hear the crowd is cheering, you know that he's doing good work, and that's one of the things Cunningham don't want to hear is when the crowd is cheering. You want to keep it what he's been doing, well, keep the crowd out of it. But now he seems like he's a little bit fatigued. He's looking to hold a little bit more than he is trying to get the action like he was doing earlier on. He was using his jab, he was stepping around, he was throwing hooks to the body and to the head, and now he's diminished to where he's holding and leaning and, you know, trying to prevent the guy from hitting him more than trying to create space.
Loves that lead right hand also. He throws that thing, I don't know if you remember, in one of the Rocky movies, when Apollo Creed finally got Balboa for their match after he trained him, and the movie ended with that right hand coming in there right at the end, and that's the way Vilarchik looks like he wants to win this fight. A good round for Vilarchik, though. His best of the fight by far. And maybe he can win this thing on those right-hand leads. It looks like there's something wrong with him, though, physically. I don't think he's been right since that knockdown in the fourth round. He's got the look of a guy who's defending his championship.
His spirit seems to be down. He's not stepping up to the plate. He started the round a bit strong, like he was about to do some damage. Even though he's done some damage in the round, but it's not one of those rounds where you have a lot of enthusiasm about himself. And, you know, as you can see here, it's more luck of Cunningham not doing anything than him doing, know, he's taking control of the fight. And I believe that he can take control of the fight if he continues to do so.
Round number 8, scheduled 12 rounder, IBF Cruiserweight Championship of the World at stake. Steve, USS Cunningham, his second shot at the title against his very same man, Krzysztof Larczyk, who hails from Poland. Larczyk, obviously the winner of the first fight, defending here, mandated by the IBF due to a technicality. Controversial scoring in the first fight. Good round in round number 7 for Larczyk as he tries to come on here, as he did in the first one, and win the latter half of the fight on the scorecard. Ed Cunningham handsomely ahead in the first 6 rounds. Larczyk starting to find a range a little bit with those big power punches here as he comes on his best exchange, backing Cunningham into the corner.
Well, he did his best work in the last round, Cunningham, and against Cunningham. And let's see if he's going to pick it up and try to take control of this fight. He got the crowd back into it, so that should be a motivating factor.
Cunningham, whether it's due to fatigue, and he did set a fairly quick pace, especially in the first 4 rounds of his fight, scored a knockdown around 4, or just tactically has decided to clinch every time Larczyk gets inside.
Yeah, I believe Cunningham is fading rather quickly here. He's not right there. He normally would throw a lot of jabs, which he did right here, and but in the previous exchange he wasn't doing that. So let's see if he pick it up.
Halfway through round number 8, Larczyk perhaps finding a spark. Still needs to find a way to get some punching range. He is very permissive in allowing Cunningham to settle for that clinch. It would behoove him to find a little punching range, maybe push off a little bit, step back and land one. He might be able to put Cunningham into such a compromising position. He's got the power that he can win this fight in a much quicker fashion.
Well, Diablo can win the fight with one punch. I mean, he's a power puncher. He shows that with his record, but Cunningham is keeping him at bay at times with the jab, and is leaning on him. He's tiring him out just by leaning on him and just keep on using the jab. And that's basically all he's doing right here. He's just using his jab, stepping around and tie up and lean on him a bit. And I would like to see these guys start establishing some other combinations in this fight instead of just holding as much as they are holding.
Paris has been pretty lenient with the clinching, almost exclusively being initiated by Steve Cunningham. At what point does he admonish Cunningham or even threaten him with a point deduction if he continues to hold every time Larczyk gets close?
In a title fight, you hate to see points taken away by a referee. You like to see the guy win the fight in the round and not by losing points on the scorecard by a referee taking away. I hope we don't see that happening.
So far, Paris has let everything go. It hasn't been so egregious that we necessarily want to see the fight decided by a point deduction. You know, look at Larczyk. He's not looked overwhelmingly comfortable in the corner, and you can see fatigue all over the face of Steve Cunningham right now.
Yeah, Cunningham is not doing the same work he started out doing, which is using the jab, creating space, throwing left hook to the head and left hook to the body, and at times put some right hand in the body as well. He was throwing that sweeping right hand in the body. He's not doing that anymore. He's basically just looking to hold and tie up. And we'd like to see him start doing that again, starting this round.
Here's round number 9, getting closer to the championship rounds. As I have Larczyk winning the last 2, Glenn, so perhaps he put himself back in this fight. Trying to influence Cunningham with these power punches now. Starting to find a home more frequently for some of those right hands. Cunningham content to tie up here. Got off to a quick early start. You don't see that pulsating jab that we saw early from Cunningham. He was really hammering it home. First couple of rounds, scored a knockdown on the 4th round. As we mentioned, we had a 2-minute round in the 5th round when Larczyk was trying to find his bearings. But he seems to be recomposed now and is doing the better work on the inside.
Well, Cunningham is not doing the work from the outside. And when he get on the inside, he just holding and tying up while Diablo is looking to punch.
Ground erupting once again. Diablo just missing a grazing right hand. Looking for anything from Vilarczyk to show that he was going to pick up his intensity in this fight. But where Cunningham was doing a great job of keeping Vilarczyk at a distance with that left-handed pressure, we're not seeing that same activity out of Steve Cunningham right now.
No, we're not. You know, this fight is basically falling to a close encounter where they're holding and they're tying and they're leaning on each other. And that space that was there between the two fighters is not there anymore. So that take away the activity from Cunningham. And Diablo is just throwing small punches on the inside, sweeping left hooks. And it's not a lot of action in the fight, but the little action is coming from Diablo.
Cunningham did pop a couple of jabs in succession for that clinch that we just saw. Inside of 1 minute to go, round of the nine. Vilarczyk coming on, crowd getting into it. Cunningham answering back with much softer shots. Vilarczyk, a cutting blow with left hand inside. Still struggling to find punching room for left hand scores. Cunningham doing the holding now, and Vilarczyk doing the better work. Not much steam on those Cunningham shots, Glenn. He looks like he's fading.
Yeah, he's fading, and he's even going to get more tired trying to throw punches on the inside with his long arm. You know, you need to get back on the outside where you can throw punches easier and it don't take as much energy. Take just as much energy to hold and to all of that grabbing and all of that stuff that's going on inside. You take just as much work and you get more tired as you do those things.
Oh man, Mo, the momentum of this fight has changed clearly and decisively in the last three rounds.
You got 10, 11, and 12,
Vilarczyk is not going to put up much of a defense of his IBF Cruiserweight Championship. Only has changed my mind and my scorecard in the last three rounds, so could be in store for another close and difficult decision.
Well, they're certainly moving in that direction. Cunningham win the early rounds. And now Diablo is coming on. He's coming on strong. You see him stepping in there and tying up and looking for some body shots. He's doing some good work. He's going sweeping left hook as you see it land here. Uppercut, he tried to land right there with a grazing uppercut.
Come on, Jimmy.
Three rounds to go. Big early advantage for Steve Cunningham, at least the way we saw it. He had a 10-8 round in round number four when he scored kind of a funky knockdown. Vilarczyk going down in a delayed reaction to a very short punch on the inside. Left hand by Steve Cunningham. 2 minute round in the fifth round. And I think Cunningham at this stage is hoping that maybe the 10th, 11th, and 12th will only go 2 minutes because his lead is disappearing slowly, but maybe significantly here. Vilarczyk fighting in his home country in front of his huge fan base here. And we saw last time that Cunningham came across seems to fight for the championship in a fight that looked like he had won it convincingly. He loses a split decision and he finds himself back in a rematch as the guy that's trying to wrestle the belt away from Vilarczyk. Good right hand that time by Vilarczyk. Vilarczyk definitely picking up the pace and picking up the power, landing with more accuracy. Cunningham tries to fire back to fend him off, but not having the same success he did in the early rounds when he was on the tips of his toes and he was dancing around the ring and he was firing that left hand. Haven't seen that jab for a while, that doubling up of the jab and tripling at different times with the left hand.
And you can see a swelling on Cunningham, you know, right over the left eye there.
Vilarczyk resigned to trying to wrestle for position with Steve Cunningham. It's been working for him though. It's a dangerous clash of heads. Cunningham trying to raise inches space. And now the pressure is coming from Vilarczyk. Minute to go, round number 10. Vilarczyk again trying to find punching room. Unable to do it, Dave Parris breaks him up. Didn't see some of the slipping that we saw in a previous fight taking place late in this one because of the unusual surface that we have, a plastic coating over the canvas and an abundance of advertising causing the fighters to lose their grip in terms of their footwork. Wild left hand missing by Vilarczyk, but he continues to come on.
Well, they're getting a bit sloppy right now. And, you know, the canvas is playing a part, but, you know, also they're getting Cunningham especially don't have the same energy level as he did earlier on in the fight.
Cunningham trying to find an angle while continuing to hold Vilarczyk. Vilarczyk's power definitely coming into play here in the second half of this fight. And a good flurry to end round number 10. And Krzysztof Vilarczyk, they slug it out to finish off the 10th. Good round for Vilarczyk, Glenn. We'll get a look in the corner at Steve USS Cunningham, who may be seeing a second opportunity to win this championship. Starting to fade just a little.
Yeah, they're getting closer on the scorecards. You can see some fatigue that's affecting Cunningham on the inside. Like, he gets clear. You know, he put both feet beside each other instead of in the boxing stand we have. The left foot in the front and the right foot in the back, him being a right-hander. As you can see here, they come together and a good right hand over the top.
And we mentioned it coming in, that's a good chin.
Ladies and gentlemen, coming in, number 11.
Fight, but definite turn of events here is Vilarczyk coming on now. Here we go, championship rounds, Glenn. 11 and 12. Krzysztof Vilarczyk from Poland, 37-1, 27 knockouts, trying to retain his championship after getting off to a sluggish start. Left hand digs it into the chin. Cunningham again, right hand now becoming effective. And the punches that Cunningham was avoiding in the first half of this fight are landing, and significantly so in the second half.
Yeah, he's establishing himself, he's getting more confident as the fight go on. And he's throwing more punches now. He's not as tight as he was early. They got another slip.
And that's really dangerous. He could suffer some severe knee damage from movement like that.
And then you see Cunningham, sometimes he even turned into a southpaw stand because, you know, he's so fatigued. Right there you see standing square, he's just pushing, both legs beside each other. Now he's almost in a southpaw stand. You know, he's really showing some fatigue here as he slipped.
He's been struggling since the march had turned this fight around and gathered the momentum in round number 7. Let's not forget, there was a 2-point round in round 4 as Vilarczyk went down. That could become even more significant if this fight goes the distance. And down goes Cunningham, but I think he just fell to the slippery canvas. There was a punch thrown. Dave Parris called that one correctly. This could get really, really dangerous out there. The tracking in this ring here in Poland, making it more and more difficult for these fighters to perform. Vilarczyk doing the better of the work here. You'd love to see him dig that left hand to the body a couple of times. It might be a little bit too much for Cunningham at this stage.
You know, I'm a big fan of body punches. Good to see. And even though it's late stage of the fight, you still want to use those body shots, but you can still get a knockdown from him. And you can still wear the guy down for the last round coming out.
There you go, let it go, let it go.
Fans getting into it. More chance of Diablo. Final 40 seconds or so of round number 11. Interesting tale of two fights here so far. First half, all Cunningham. Speed, keeping Vilarczyk off him, good use of the jab, effective combination punching. Second half, all Vilarczyk. as Cunningham has been virtually skating around the ring now the last couple of rounds. Barczyk has landed more and heavy blows. Final 10 seconds, round 11.
He's using his job again.
Fading Steve Cunningham is going to go to his stool, trying to win a championship here in the 12th and final round.
That's another close game.
Wow. Barczyk winning the last final by scorecard. And then they had Steve Cunningham winning the first six, including a 10-8 job. So still a slight edge for Steve Cunningham. But this is definitely a close fight, and we saw what happened the last time, and we're not surprising if the judges saw something around here.
You have to take all the energy that you have left in your body and try to put it into this round and try to win the last round and win a championship here. And if he wants to win the fight, this is something that he has to do. And Diablo want to keep his belt. He's going to have the same idea. And, you know, he's going to have some sense of being behind. So he's going to come out and try to do the same thing. So this round should be an exciting round. Let's see what happens.
There it is, title on the line. IBF Cruiserweight Championship of the World at stake here, round number 12, the 12th and final at the Spodek Arena. Diablo, hearing the chants of the crowd, perhaps to inspire him to pull another victory out, much as he did the first time these two men met. Cunningham trying to fend him off, and Len, it's hard to find that resolve. I don't know that we've seen Steve Cunningham show signs that he has that kind of resolve against this particular fighter to come on and reverse the trend that has been the last four or five rounds.
And both of these guys now, they're trying to impose their will. This is the last round, and they're trying to close the show. But they're still having problem with their footing, especially Cunningham, because he has such a wide stand, it's easier for him to slide.
Well, whenever he's on one of those advertisements, he cannot set his plant foot and has to back out of there. Barczyk, though, here in his 12th round, hasn't been able to capitalize. This could be a decisive round here, this fight on the scorecards. Very possibly so. I'm sure both men are well aware of that. The knockdown could be the difference on the scorecards. Cunningham achieving that in round number four. So much at stake here in round number 12, though, Glenn.
For both guys, I mean, you know, this is a further championship. The winner going to get an opportunity to fight in another big fight. And even though it's slappy and it doesn't look good, but all you care about right here is just get out of here with a win, man. I'm sure both guys have that in mind right now, and they're trying to accomplish that in a close fight on the final round. Got a little bit over a minute to go, and they're trying to do what they can.
Cunningham may be doing enough to pull one out of the fire here in this 12th and final. He seemed to have found something in his inner self while sitting on the stool in the 11th round. Good combination there by Cunningham. Barczyk tries to answer back. Cunningham spins him around, and now another clinch in the corner here as Cunningham literally tries to hold on and win this championship, capitalizing on the early lead he built on the scorecards. Barczyk, couple of left hands, vintage Barczyk there on the inside, looking for punching room. Cunningham looking for the bell, perhaps. Here it is, 12th and final. Both fighters a little bit fatigued and really struggling with the conditions inside the ring. 20 seconds to go in the IBF Cruiserweight Championship. Cunningham hanging on. Barczyk also looking very tired. Inside 10 seconds, crowd going nuts, hoping Diablo can pull this out. Final seconds of this championship bout, and there's the bell. And this is not going to be an easy assignment for the judges, Glenn. I thought Cunningham did enough in that 12th round to win that 12th round. And I have him as a slight edge on the scorecards winning this fight, and I think the knockdown is going to play a significant role.
What would happen if a draw happened here? You think they would have a third fight?
It's an interesting question. When you look at the cruiserweight division, outside of a couple of guys at the top, Mormick and O'Neill Bell, nondescript guys in there. Kokarev was a guy who was promising. And these two guys, I'm not sure with those two styles, 35 would be that compelling, but an awful lot on the line right now.
Look at the numbers and come up with a decision here. And if I have to give it to anybody, I'd have to say Cunningham. But again, when you're in the next man hometown, and he might get the benefit of the doubt, it's quite close. It's not a comfortable situation to be in, the fight being this close. He had a great lead starting the fight, but he faded in the end and allowed Diablo to catch up, and now it's a close fight to go either way.
I got my computer around. I have a 115-112. Steve, USS Cunningham. If I'm judging, we have a new IBF Cruiserweight champion. I had a 10-8 round in round number four. As Cunningham scored a knockdown, and Marchuk appeared to be affected by that for the next couple of rounds, and then he found himself as Cunningham looked like he tired a little bit from that early effort. Great job by Cunningham coming out of the chute through six rounds, and then I had Marchuk winning every round from that point on except for the last, and the conditions also became a factor, I think, compromising Cunningham, especially, as you say, Glenn, with that wide stance. But the judges with a tough decision. Let's not forget hometown turf here for Krzysztof Walarczyk. He got the advantage of the pencil last time. This was a closer fight, I think, than the last one. Last time I thought Cunningham won it a little bit more convincingly. This time I have him by 3 points. But you could make a case for a draw in this fight also.
Well, the difference in the fight is the knockout. And here we go.
Bardzo proszę zawodników, to była walka o tytuł mistrza świata federacji IBF kategorii junior ciężkiej. Sędziowie punktowali. Sędzia Lopez 116 do 112. Kanina.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 12 championship rounds, we go to the judges' scorecard, where the judge Alejandro Lopez scores this bout. 116 to 112 for Cunningham.
Sędzia Kinson, 114 do 114. To był rewiz, proszę Państwa.
Ladies and gentlemen, Judge Bob Gibson scores this bout. 114 to 114, a draw.
I sędzia z Tajlandii, 115 do 112, Kanina.
Ladies and gentlemen, Judge Somerset Sherman scores this bout. 115 to 112 for your winner and the new IBF Cruiserweight Champion of the World, Steve USS Cunningham.
And Cunningham gets the nod, Glenn Johnson. 115-112 on one scorecard. 116-112, both judges for Steve Cunningham. And the third judge making a majority decision, called it a draw. We have a new champion. It's been a pleasure being with you. I'm Jeff DeForest for Glenn Johnson. Good night, everybody.